What's up, chickies? It's Baron here. Today we're going to be going over the Drake Corsair and whether or not you should buy it. Now, I have done a video on this in the past. Now, I'm doing this again because I'm purely, I've discriminated against this shipping a little bit. And I've gone over it and I have got one in my hanger now. So I thought it'd be worth actually doing a video on one now again. So doing a revisit, seeing that you guys will be interested in it. And I know it's going to be coming out next year sometime because they are working on it. So keep that in mind. It's going to be a really great ship. And the exploration and the defensive side of this is insane. Like, the amount of weapons this thing has, it is crazy. So on this ship, you have four size 5s that are gimbaled a size 4. So I don't know if they're going to be, like, you'll be able to change them to size 5s. And that's pilot controls them as well. And then you've got 2x size 4 gimbals, which are their size 3 gimbaled weapons, which is insane. So hopefully these can be changed to, you know, a size 4 and then the size 5s. And then you got 2x size 2 with dual mounts on each. Then you got a 1x size 2 with a dual mount, and you got 8x size 3 missiles, if I am correct. Now, in the back of it, you may have, you know, S72 SCU of cargo. Now, we know ships have been changing lately, like the Banu Merchantman, but we haven't really heard any updates on the Corsair. So I'm going to go ahead and say that this thing's going to be staying sort of around the same sort of size, the same sort of perspective, and everything in this ship isn't going to change. 72 SCU of cargo in the back, and the ability to hold an Ursa Rover or a small vehicle. So you have an engineering area just in front of the like the back cargo area, and from there it looks like there's a few small rooms running off it. And then moving forward, there is an advanced personnel quarters with 3 beds, a mess hall, washing facilities. And then if you move a little bit further forward towards the bridge, you have 2 turret entrances left and right. So as you move on from there, in the very front section, you have a captain's quarters, and then you have the bridge. Now, in the bridge, you have a co-pilot and a pilot seat. Now, the co-pilot can actually jump in their seat, and what happens is it actually traverses under the pilot seat. So if you have something like that set up, it's going to be a little bit more evasive, and you won't be able to really have any more. Well, you probably have a few sort of issues there, but it's going to be making it easy for the co-pilot to see as well as the pilot, and you're not going to really have that person in front of you, so you're going to be able to see a little bit better. That's what the whole point of that was. They didn't want the co-pilot, like when you are in the Drake Cutlass, to have that sort of issue where someone will be in front of you and you won't be able to see what you're really doing, and you'll have to go to F4. So that was one of their biggest things when they designed that ship. So going into the components, we know that this has got some medium components on it, and that the shield might be updated. I'm not too sure if it's been updated to a large, as this is supposed to compete with the Connie Andromeda and the Constellation series. So it has 1x2 radar, 1x1 computer, 2x2 power plants, 2x2 coolers, 2x2 shield generators, 2x2 fuel intakes, 2x2 fuel tanks, 1x2 quantum drive, 1x2 jump drive, and 2x2 quantum fuel tank. So there's a fair bit going on there. There's a fair few components, and it, you know, they haven't like skimped out on the quantum fuel tanks, which is really, really good. So four people can use the front forward lift that this ship has got for the crew members to get in. Each crew member can store 1 set of armor, which is also really good. And if you're wondering about the price, it's not that bad. Like, the 400i is more expensive than this, which doesn't really make much sense. I guess because it's just gone straight to flyable, that's why it might be worth what it is. And once this ship comes out, it'll be worth a little bit more. So for the standalone at a normal price, it is $215. If you were to get it on War Bond, it is $195. So at the same time, I feel it is a really good choice to get this ship. I feel like I did take a little bit out of it and, you know, criticize it a little too harshly last time. And I've done this to a lot of ships. It's not just this one. Like the Crusader line, the C2, M2, and A2, I was a little harsh on them. So I think doing revisits on videos like this and ships like these is really good. At the same time, I sort of got to take in, you know, the judgment and sort of think about what I want and what I'm doing. But I know it's about what you guys want as well. But I do have a Cutlass Corsair, well, not a Cutlass Corsair, sorry, a Drake Corsair in my hangar. So that's also a part of this, of why I rethought it. A lot of people changed my perspective on this ship. Now, going off the information, I'm not always trying to, you know, sell ships to you guys, but I'm just trying to give you the best knowledge in my mind that I can give you to actually make the educated decision to buy a ship. Now, when I tell you to buy a ship, you don't have to buy that ship. You are your own person. You can have the ability to say, no, I don't want to buy that. But I have one in my hangar. I was very biased towards it. The old video will be in the cards, so go check that out. But I've been Baron. I hope you enjoy this. See you in the verse.